Can you believe what you have been seeing on CNN today, ladies and gentlemen? Can you believe it? Supposedly, a CNN reporter found Osama bin Laden, took a television camera crew with him, went into Osama bin Laden's hideout, interviewed him and his top leadership, his top lieutenants and colonels and generals in their hideout. This is a CNN reporter with a camera crew. And he came out and told everybody, within 3 weeks, Osama bin Laden is going to attack the United States and Israel. Now, don't you think that's kind of strange, folks? You see, because the largest intelligence apparatus in the world, with the biggest budget in the history of the world, has been looking for Osama bin Laden for years and years and years, and can't find him. A reporter from CNN and his little camera crew got in to Osama bin Laden's secret hideout and conducted an interview. If you don't believe me, tune into CNN. They're probably running it right now as I'm speaking. And if you believe it, you are one of the stupidest jerks that ever lived on the face of this earth. And whatever is going to happen that they're going to blame on Osama bin Laden, don't you even believe it.
Beyond the 60 apprehended or detained and many deported since September 11th, another group of 140 Israeli individuals have been arrested and detained in this year in what government documents describe as, quote, an organized intelligence gathering operation designed to, quote, penetrate government facilities. Most of those individuals said they had served in the Israeli military, which is compulsory there, but they also had, most of them, intelligence expertise and either worked for Amdocs or other companies in Israel that specialize in wiretapping. Earlier this week, the Israeli embassy here in Washington denied any spying against or in the United States.
Carl, what about this question of advanced knowledge of what was going to happen on 9/11? How clear are investigators that some Israeli agents may have known something?
Well, it's very explosive information, obviously, and there's a great deal of evidence that they say they have collected. None of it necessarily conclusive. It's more when they put it all together. A bigger question, they say, is how could they not have known? Almost a direct quote, Brett.
The most phenomenal part of this report is not that it was eventually erased from the web by Fox News itself, but that it ever made it to the air at all. In December of 2001, Fox News investigative reporter Carl Cameron filed an explosive four-part series that went in-depth into an Israeli art student spying ring that had been under investigation before 9/11, extensive Israeli wiretapping of sensitive U.S. government communications, and the 60 Israeli spies that were detained in the wake of the September 11th attacks. Unsurprisingly, the story was quickly dropped, and no mainstream journalists dared to continue probing into the matter. This is the real story of Israeli spies in 9/11. Not some vague rumors about some dancing Israelis, but an FBI dragnet that swept up the largest foreign spying ring ever caught red-handed on American soil. And although the FBI were convinced that these spies knew about 9/11 in advance, their investigations were stifled and the issue was swept under the rug. Rather than making Israel enemy number one in the war on terror, Israel remains to this day the U.S.'s most important ally.
And if I'm fortunate enough to be elected president, the United States will reaffirm we have a strong and enduring national interest in Israel's security.
In 2001, weeks after the attacks on New York City and on Washington, and frankly, the attacks on all of us, attacks that perpetrated, and they were perpetrated by the Islamic fundamentalists. Mayor Rudy Giuliani visited Israel to show solidarity with terror victims. I sent my plane because I backed the mission for Israel 100%.
But perhaps this is understandable. After all, we all remember how Yasser Arafat gloated about 9/11 and said it was good for Palestinians, right? Oh wait, that wasn't Yasser Arafat. It was Benjamin Netanyahu.
The Israeli newspaper Ma'ariv has reported Israel's former Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has publicly said the September 11th attacks have been good for Israel. Netanyahu said, quote, "We're benefiting from one thing, and that is the attack on the Twin Towers and Pentagon and the American struggle in Iraq."
My name is Donald Trump, and I'm a big fan of Israel. And frankly, a strong prime minister is a strong Israel. And you truly have a great prime minister. In Benjamin Netanyahu, there's nobody like him. He's a winner. He's highly respected. He's highly thought of by all. And people really do have great, great respect for what's happened in Israel. So vote for Benjamin. Terrific guy, terrific leader, great for Israel.
Given that the ultimate consequence of 9/11 was the beginning of a now 15-year-long struggle to transform the Middle East, a struggle that the neocons that went on to populate the Bush administration had been openly advocating since the Clean Break policy paper in the mid-1990s, it isn't hard to see how the September 11th attacks were indeed a boon for Israel. But information linking Israeli spies to advanced knowledge of 9/11 remains classified information. In a world of true justice, the dancing Israelis and other Israeli spies with insider advanced knowledge of the 9/11 attacks, who openly celebrated those attacks, would be the targets of the war on terror, not its beneficiaries.
Some evil is just, it can't be explained.
Are these people happy? Are they joyous now? Are they celebrating?
Oh, absolutely. They're celebrating.
God.
There's one report. This has not been confirmed, but there's...
I actually figure very largely in a number of the key conspiracy theories.
September 11th, September 11th. Terrorists or terrorism? September 11th.
I will not die.
New York. I got to know him.
You were at his wedding?
I was at his wedding. That's right.
Did he register for gifts at his wedding?
I don't remember.
Did you get him a wedding gift?
I went to his wedding.
So you guys were apparently friendly. I know he said he told Greta Van Susteren that
right.
he something to the effect of, I don't want to get his quote wrong because I'll be killed by him. He said he thinks you're a terrific woman and you were doing a good job, which is a bold thing to say about Hillary Clinton on Fox News. But now you guys are running against each other, and he says you're the worst Secretary of State in the history of the United States. Is it like professional wrestling where you guys all pretend to dislike each other to win these elections, and then you're all pals behind the scenes?
And you're all pals behind the scenes.
No, you've been a good friend, and that's in the thick and thin. And I know it's never gonna end.
Hillary Clinton, I think, is a terrific woman. I mean, I'm a little biased because I've known her for years. I live in New York, she lives in New York, and I've known her and her husband for years, and I really like them both a lot. And I think she really works hard, and I think she, again, she's given an agenda. It's not all of her, but I think she really works hard, and I think she does a good job, and I like her.
Do you think that she says she's out at the end of this term? Do you think we're going to see her again running for office?
I think so. I think, you know, assuming she's healthy, which I hope she will be, I think she probably runs after the next 4 years, I would imagine.
You support her?
I don't want to get into this because I'll get myself into trouble. But
that's
just
why
like
I asked
her.
You to see if you get into trouble.
I just like her. I like her, and I like her husband. Her husband made a speech on Monday at Mar-a-Lago, and it was very well received. And he's a really good guy, and she's a really good person and woman.
I love you.
No confidence problem at all for Del Kim. I love that about him.
Yeah, that in spite of the fact that, as we pointed out, that we think that Miss Tismacher has her number, judging by the recent series of matches that they have had, even to the point where Tismacher beat Gail three times on Impact Wrestling over the course of the past month or so.
Yeah, totally. Listen, if someone, go for a quick pin. Someone beat you that many times consecutively. I mean, you gotta worry. But if Gail Kim is worried, she didn't show it to us on Thursday night, and definitely not showing it right now.
I'm curious about the pool of molten steel that was found in the bottom of the towers.
I am too.
And
please tell me about it. Have you seen it?
Well, not personally, but eyewitnesses there found huge poles of molten steel beneath the towers, and some scientists don't think that the collapse of the building could have melted all that steel. And physics professor analyzed some of the steel, and Stephen Jones, and he found evidence of thermate residue, mm-hmm. which would explain how the buildings collapsed by means of pre-planted explosives. So, have you analyzed the steel for any of those residues?
First of all, let's go back to your basic premise that there was a pool of molten steel. I know of absolutely nobody, no eyewitness who has said so, nobody who's produced it. I was on the site, I was on the steel yards, so I don't know that that's so.
There's video of it.
Steel melted around 2,600 degrees Fahrenheit. I think it's probably pretty difficult to get that kind of temperatures in a fire.
You'd get down below and you'd see molten steel, steel running down the channel rails. Like you're in a foundry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like lava.
Like lava. You'd get down below and you'd see molten steel, steel running down the channel rails. Like you're in a foundry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like lava.
Like lava. You'd get down below and you'd see molten steel.
Yeah, like
molten steel running down the channel rails. Like you're in a foundry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like lava.
Like lava. You'd get down below and you'd see molten steel.
Yeah, like
molten steel running down the channel rails. Like you're in a foundry.
Mm-hmm.
Like
in part because of the challenge posed by Iran, we have engaged in an unprecedented level of military, intelligence, and security cooperation with our friend and ally, Israel. We are determined to help our ally address new and complex security threats and to ensure its qualitative military edge. We work with Israel every day to enforce sanctions and prevent terrorist organizations such as Hamas and Hezbollah from obtaining the financing and the weapons that they seek, whether from Iran or from any other source. And we will stand with Israel to stop its adversaries from once again launching deadly and unprovoked attacks against the Israeli people. Since 2009, we have provided $20 billion in foreign military financing to Israel, more than half of what we have given to nations worldwide. Over and above that, we have invested some $3 billion in the production and deployment of Iron Dome batteries and other missile defense programs and systems. And we saw how in the last Gaza war, lives were saved in Israel because of it. We have given privileged access to advanced military equipment, such as the F-35 Joint Strike Fighter. Israel is the only nation in the Middle East to which the United States has sold this fifth-generation aircraft. The President recently authorized a massive arms resupply package featuring penetrating munitions and air-to-air missiles, and we hope soon to conclude a new memorandum of understanding, a military assistance plan that will guide our intensive security cooperation through the next decade. And diplomatically, our support for Israel also remains rock solid. As we continue to oppose every effort to delegitimize the Jewish state or to pass biased resolutions against it in international bodies.
All 220 floors of the World Trade Center were pulverized, and the metal pans, the 4 inches of concrete, and the metal pans that held them were turned into dust. And the dust rolled through Manhattan, and this is what you would call pyroclastic clouds, meaning that they contain fire. Because these clouds contained all those little tiny droplets of molten iron, either in the molten state or just turned into hardened steel. So when this hot dust hit cars, for example, it would scorch the car. It would scorch the side that got hit first, right? And when people got hit by this dust, they got burned. Like William Rodriguez, he was hiding under a, he went for protection under a fire truck, and when the blast hit him, it burned his leg. Because this dust, these dust clouds contained molten iron. And obviously they pulverized everything in the tower and everything that was on those floors. Nothing was found of these people. These 2,700 people just basically vanished into dust. Nothing was found, nothing. Yet there were 2,000, there were 3,000 families who had wrongful death cases. And those people were all settled out of court. The first 2,900 cases were settled out of court with federal compensation. They took the money and signed. There were then 96 families who held out for a court process. These 96 families appeared in the court of Alvin K. Hellerstein in New York, in the District Court of New York. There's a problem here, though, is that Alvin K. Hellerstein had a conflict of interest. His son worked for the key defendant in the tort litigation. His son lives in Israel and is a lawyer for an Israeli company who works for the Rothschild company that owned ICTS, International Consultants of Target Security, who controlled airport security on 9/11 in this country. So when these characters went in through Boston Airport, Newark Airport, Dulles Airport, wherever they got on, they went through Israeli security. From a Dutch company, an Israeli-Dutch company. It's just based in Holland. Mossad company, owned by the Rothschilds. This company was the key defendant in the tort litigation because the families wanted to know, how did the 19 Arabs get on the planes with the Arabs and the box cutters with everything? How did they get on the planes? And ICTS, this Israeli company, would have had to answer that information, would have had to give the evidence. What did the judge do? Hellerstein, in his court in New York, he excused the company. He said, "You're just the parent company. I don't know what you're doing here. You can go home." And his son in Israel is working for that company. This is a fundamental primary family conflict of interest and is a strong ethical violation. But I, no matter how much I shouted about this, I couldn't get the authorities or the newspapers in New York to pay any attention. Finally, Ellen Mariani's lawyer took it to the Supreme Court and simply said that I want this information to be put into the document. Into the document. That's all we're asking. The U.S. Supreme Court denied it, and they said, they scolded the lawyer, and they said, you're anti-Semitic. Simply for trying to get this information into the court record. So the people who were responsible for this, what I call a judicial war of attrition, in which all of the families, you have to understand, there were 3,000 families, lost 3,000 people, and not a single case ever went to court. How can it be in this country, huh? Well, it's because Kenneth Feinberg, a big Zionist, he oversaw the special compensation fund. He gave the money to every single family, in which mum's the word, you can't talk about how much you got, no, terms cannot be discussed, you have to be, just take the money, shut up, and go home. End of discussion. That's what they did with the first 2,900 families. The other 96 families had to deal with Sheila Birnbaum down here, a partner with Skadden Arps, a legal firm that is very close to the state of Israel, and she worked with those 96 families. And one by one, that's like three times as many people are here, one by one, each family was settled out of court. Every family was settled out of court. So there will never be a 9/11 case trial in this country, because everybody that had standing has been settled. That's called a travesty of justice. This man is also involved in the 9/11 saga. He's the former attorney general. He also belongs to the same Zionist Orthodox congregation that Judge Hellerstein belongs to. It's called the Kehillat Jeshurun, I think it's called, in Manhattan. It's Orthodox Zionist. This man presided over the first bombing in the World Trade Center in 1993. Remember? When the FBI basically created the sting operation, put the bomb in the building, and then had and paid $1 million to an Egyptian colonel to basically snare a bunch of Muslims into his orbit, who would then be indicted and charged with the crime. The blind cleric, maybe you remember the blind sheikh? Those guys went to jail for like the next 5,000 years. But he's the man who oversaw this case. The purpose of the 1993 bombing was to put into our heads that Arabs are trying to blow up the World Trade Center. So when it did happen 8 years later, we said, oh yeah, sure. Didn't you see the movie? In the end, the guy says, next time we'll bring them both down. And so that when it happened, people automatically, oh yeah, the Arabs did it, sure, who else? What also, what other case he presided over, was Larry Silverstein's case with the insurance companies. Remember, Larry Silverstein, the owner of the World Trade Center, he only got like 4 weeks before, was suing the insurance companies for double indemnity, saying that this is two attacks, not one. I want twice the money. In his courtroom of this Zionist Orthodox Jew, he got double indemnity. He got like $7.5 billion. For buildings that had been public buildings only a month before, which he had put down only $100 million of borrowed money from GMAC to get. And he becomes a billionaire overnight. 9/11 is a crime within a crime within a crime. Believe me, it's multifaceted, and it's deep. And it's like a Russian Madroshka doll, that you open it up, and inside there's another doll, another doll, another doll. In the middle of the doll, you get to the Israeli Zionist doll. You pass through Arabs and Russians and Chinese and German death cults and Alex Jones and a lot of other things. But when you get to the very inner core of the Madroshka doll, the core, you find the Israelis. So that's the purpose of my information, my book, is I cut to the chase. I find who's really responsible for 9/11. And what we find at every key point in this crime, it's either a Zionist, an Israeli agent himself, or an American Zionist who is very closely connected to the highest level of the Israeli government. These are not just like people who have a warm and fuzzy feeling for the state of Israel. These are people who are connected to the very top. Like this man, Mr. Bloomberg, served three terms, unprecedented, mayor of New York for 12 years after 9/11, suppressed all discovery of the crime, threatened the police, threatened the firefighters, suppressed the information. Here he is, a close friend of Ehud Barak. When Ehud Barak was bombing, this is when he's dropping white phosphorus on the people of Gaza. Bloomberg goes there and holds his hand and says, it's okay, we understand. Sometimes those Palestinians need some white phosphorus. You know, I guess that's just, you know, they just won't listen. You know, they're throwing scuds at you, or they're throwing those bottle rockets at you. We've got to drop phosphorus on them, which is, of course, a criminal act. Here he is, good buddies with Mr. Netanyahu. I don't know what they're talking about here. What's interesting about Mr. Netanyahu, Bibi Netanyahu, this man is, I think I've tried to present to you tonight, is the godfather of the war on terror. He's the Prime Minister of Israel today. He's the chairman of the Likud party. He's a psychopathic liar, if you've ever seen him speak. He had every Sunday afternoon, he had a conversation for years prior to 9/11. Every Sunday afternoon, he spoke with Mr. Larry Silverstein, who is the godfather of the 9/11 attacks. So what was it that these two men had to talk about every Sunday afternoon? And this is not me making this up. This is from the Israeli media, Haaretz. Haaretz means the land, right? Haaretz, Eretz Israel. Haaretz is the land. And it's up in smoke by Sarah Leibovitz Starr, November 2001. So what were they talking about? Football scores? Unlikely. This is the planning. As my German expert said, this required years of planning. As I've shown you tonight, it required decades of planning. Not years, decades. Here we see Mayor Bloomberg showing around in September 2011. He's showing the Netanyahu's around this memorial they're building, the new memorial, the memorial, the fountains and things like that. Well, Mr. Netanyahu knows very well what those pools are going to look like because guess who made them? His Israeli buddy here. The 9/11 memorial was designed and built by Michael Arad. Michael Arad is the son of the former ambassador, Israeli ambassador to the United States, Moshe Arad. Moshe Arad is a very good friend of the Netanyahu's. So this is what I want to try to show you is that at every single point of the 9/11 saga, from the ideation that came out in the 1970s, the movies, all the way through to the setting up of the crime, to the crime itself, to the cover-up, to the foisting of the false narrative to the war on terror, at every single point, it's an Israeli or a very devoted, you know, supporter of the State of Israel. Even the legacy of what happened there is in the hands of Israelis. How can that be? And we're supposed to think that Arabs did this, or German death cult, or Illuminati?
Sure.
Here it is, when Larry Silverstein obtained the keys to the front door of the World Trade Center, July 24th, 2001. How did he get the World Trade Center 1 month and 2 weeks before the attacks? How did that happen? He got it through his Zionist connection. His Zionist connection is Larry Silverstein was the national chairman of the UJA Federation of New York. This is the main funding arm for the State of Israel, United Jewish Appeal Federation. So he was the chairman of the board, national chairman. And on his planning board was this other man, Lou Eisenberg, who went on to become the Port Authority. He was the Port Authority Executive Director. As Executive Director of the Port Authority, Mr. Eisenberg oversaw the negotiations which brought the public property of the World Trade Center. The World Trade Center was public property. It then became privatized in June and went to this man. And this is the man who got the $7.5 billion simply because of a good insurance policy. His claim to fame prior to this was that he was indicted in a drug case with Bill Clinton, which was, of course, dismissed. And he was the owner of a strip club near the airport called Runway 69. That's it. And he's the head of this Zionist fundraising apparatus. So it's like the connection that these two men have is through this Zionist fundraising charity, UJA. So that what happened is that Lou Eisenberg made sure that the Vornado Realty would not get the contract, that when Vornado Realty, who was the expected recipient of the lease, got up and walked away from the table, they simply gave it to Larry Silverstein. Here's Larry Silverstein with his good buddy. You know, these are partners. These are basically partners in the biggest crime of the century. This is Larry Silverstein's partner in the lease. This is an Israeli commando born in Czechoslovakia named Frank Lowy. This man owns Westfield properties in this country. So there's many shopping malls in California and Florida called Westfield. He owns them. And he got the lease for the retail space underneath the World Trade Center. And this is the man, Ronald Lauder, the son of Estee Lauder from the cosmetic company. This man is very closely tied to the Mossad. He has a school at Mossad University in Herzliya. And this is the man who oversaw the privatization program for the state of New York under Governor Pataki. This is the man who decided that, yes, we will privatize the World Trade Center and put the ball into motion, which brought the World Trade Center into the hands of Larry Silverstein. So I'm just showing you that at every point in this operation, there is a player who is very highly connected to the state of Israel. This is not accident. This is not anything anti-Semitic on my part to point this out. I'm simply pointing out that the key players in this crime are all Zionists and Israelis. So you can understand what is the nature of the crime we're talking about. What is the nature of the war on terror? This is a Zionist construct, and we have to understand that, because only when we undeceive ourselves and undeceive the people around us and undeceive our society will we be liberated from this agenda of war, which we are now married to. The agenda of war has cost this nation a great deal of blood and money, and it's not over. They intend to take this war agenda further to Iran, to Russia, which will be detrimental to the American Republic. It will destroy us, which is why it is in our best interest to stop this as soon as possible. Here's Mr. Netanyahu with Mr. Ehud Olmert. Ehud Olmert was the former Prime Minister of Israel, who just happened to be in New York City on September 11th. Yet it was not reported in any of the newspapers in New York City. He's the mayor of the sister city of New York, Jerusalem. He's the deputy mayor, he's the deputy prime minister of the state of Israel. Yet when he comes to Israel on September, when he comes to New York City on September 10th, nobody says anything about it. But they all know he's there. Why the secrecy? 10 days later, he came back to New York and held Giuliani's hand and said, you know, well, we understand this. We're experts in terrorism. We can help you. So from the devastation of 9/11, there is a little bright light, that little bright light that's shining there. And that bright light is that this crime, when you understand the deception of this crime, when you understand the players involved, when you understand that this is the Achilles heel to this crimeocracy that runs this country, by exposing the deception, by understanding the people who are involved in it, we can remove this crimeocracy from our country. But we can't do it if we don't prosecute these people, if we don't understand who did it, and if we don't hold these people accountable. That is the struggle of our time. And the thing is that, like a friend of mine says, if you look through history, you will see that big change comes from movements, not from politicians. So don't hold your breath and think that Donald Trump or Bernie Sanders is going to solve 9/11 for us. And, you know, no foreign country is going to be able to do it for us. We have to do it for ourselves. This is an American problem. This is our country. This is our world. And the only way we're going to rectify the problem is to personally take ownership of it and do something about it. And the best thing we can do is spread the information to our friends and our fellow citizens and bring about an increase of awareness, because this is a revolution of awareness and a revolution of consciousness. We cannot go up against these guys in Washington with guns like those guys tried to do down in Burns. You can't go up against these guys with strength, with guns, or with violence. They will vilify you, then kill you, and then vilify you some more. What do you accomplish? You're dead. We have to stay alive. We have to stay healthy. We have to stay happy. We have to get our sense of humor back, laugh at this stuff, and spread the word. Be positive. Don't be afraid. Don't listen to Alex Jones and tremble and say, oh, FEMA knows about me, and NSA reads my email, and I better not write to Mr. Bolin or send him any money because they'll know about me, and I'll be in a FEMA camp. Drop it. Forget the fear. There's nothing to be afraid of. The thing you have to be afraid of is doing nothing and letting this agenda go forward another day. That's what we have to stop. So with that, I want to thank you for coming. It's a really nice crowd. It's a pleasure to be here again.